Our speaker today, Erik Qualman. Erik is often called a digital Dale Carnegie. Erik is the author of Socialnomics, How Social Media Transforms the Way We Live and Do Business. Socialnomics made Amazon's number one best-selling list for the US, Japan, the UK, Canada, Portugal, Italy, China, Korea, and Germany. So it's all over. His book, Digital Leader, propelled him to be voted the second most likable author in the world, behind Harry Potter's J.K. Rowling. You know, hard to beat her. Fast Company listed him as a top 100 digital influencer, and PC Magazine ranks his blog as a top 10 social media blog. He recently gave the commencement address to 4,000 people at the University of Texas, and has been featured on almost every media outlet, including 60 Minutes, The Wall Street Journal, Forbes, and ABC News. Socialnomics was a finalist for the Book of the Year, and earlier this year, Qualman was named a top 50 professor in the world. Qualman wrote and produced the world's most watched social media video, Social Media Revolution. In his past, Qualman was an academic All-Big Ten in basketball at Michigan State University. He rooted for Louisville last night, he told me. And in 2011, Erik was honored as the Michigan State University Alum of the Year. It's my pleasure to welcome Erik Qualman to the stage.
Well, thank you. It's an honor to be here. I think my mom even voted for J.K. Rowling, so it wasn't even close. But I want to tell you a quick story because I've been flying a lot lately, and I've been meeting a lot of great people. And I met this guy on the plane recently. He's an older gentleman, and we were chatting up about life and kids and family. And halfway through the conversation, about 20 minutes in, I go, well, what do you do for a living? And he goes, well, I'm a musician. And what he didn't realize is that I was going to bombard him and tell him for the next 10 minutes, oh, if you use digital media, these mobile tools, you can get your name out there, you can sell a lot of records. And this lady comes up and she asks for an autograph. And so I'm super excited. I can't wait to tell my wife and my two daughters. I go, someone recognized me on the plane. That never happens. But she leans across me to get Mr. James Taylor's autograph. Five-time Grammy Award-winning James Taylor's autograph. This is a little of his music, if you're not familiar with it. And so I'm sitting there going, oh my gosh, we've got 3 more hours on this flight, and I was just telling James Taylor, if only you use social media, you might have some form of success. And it got worse from there because I watched TV that week, and 2 days later he was performing live at the Grammys, so that's why he was flying to L.A. But anyways, hopefully what I tell you today is a little more relevant than what I was telling James Taylor. But since we're here in Lamar, and I know your coach is Coach Knight, I had to bring up this image of me playing basketball, and that's Coach Knight right there, number 25. So very small world. I'm very honored at Michigan State to have my number retired there, and very fortunate to have it retired. Fortunate because it was another player that came after me that actually won a national championship and played in the NBA for 10 years, Morris Peterson, that also wore number 42, so that's why it's retired. In trivia question, 42 is Jackie Robinson's number, so that's coming out later this year, the movie. It might be out already. But before I get into anything, I want to show a video that was talked about in the introduction because I think it sets a good stage to where we are today. So I'm going to play this video, and then we'll talk a little bit more about Socialnomics.
Thank you. right, so the video kind of showcases that we don't really have a choice on whether we do social media. The choice is on how well we do it. And if we look at socialnomics, what does that term even mean? At a 10-second level, socialnomics just means word of mouth on digital steroids. Or word of mouth is now world of mouth. So no matter what we do, whether it's personal branding, whether it's a Fortune 500 company, whether it's nonprofit, whether it's government, whether it's B2B, is that all of us use social media because it's less about technology and it's really all about those relationships. And this has been going on for thousands of years, that the best businesses are driven by word of mouth. And now it just takes it to a whole new level when word of mouth is on that proverbial digital steroids. So if we look at that, it sounds good in theory in terms of what does that mean? It means that all of us will have access to our friends, what they like and what they don't like. And so that's a beautiful thing for a customer, because now we don't have to do all that research per se. Because if 10 of our friends already did the research for the best hotel, why would we be redundant in doing that research? So that's a beautiful thing for a customer from a standpoint of it eliminates that multiple individual redundancy, and so you have more time left to do the things that you love. Now for a business, that's also a great thing, because if you're the business producing that product or service of value, all of a sudden your customer, your client, is going to tell your story for you. And that's why we saw in the video that 90% of us trust what our peers say, but only 14% of us trust what advertising says about us. So what does that look like in the real world? In the real world, it's already happening in different market segments. So if we look at TripAdvisor or a tool called Yelp, what they're using is Facebook Connect. Now, Facebook Connect, if you were to explain it to your grandparents, essentially allows you just to have one login. No matter what website you go to, you just have to remember your Facebook login. So that's great, because now we can kind of get rid of those yellow post-it notes we all have around our desk or on our iPad or on our computer screen. But the more powerful thing, and these are two screenshots, one's from Yelp, but I'm going to focus on TripAdvisor. How many of you guys use TripAdvisor? Okay, most of you guys use TripAdvisor when you're obviously going on vacation. And so historically, it's been a great tool because it'll tell you, hey, there's 104 ratings and reviews for this hotel that you're interested in going to at Cabo San Lucas. And they still have that. But now what they're doing is they're layering that with also what your friends think about that hotel. So through Facebook Connect, what you can see is on this screenshot, on the lower hand corner of this, 40 of my friends have been to Cabo San Lucas. And if I click down further on that, it'll tell me that 10 of them stayed at that hotel I'm researching, and all of them give it 4 or 5 stars. So that's a huge change for me as a consumer. That's very valuable. Now I booked that hotel, I don't have to worry about it. Now, some of you guys might be thinking, well, I have some friends that have terrible taste in hotels. But you know that, so you'll discredit them. Or if they have terrible taste in a restaurant, you go, I'm not listening to that person, but I'll listen to my foodie friends. So that's the difference. It's a lot more powerful. It's layering on top of what already exists. So in time, all products and services will be rated. So we've already seen it in the restaurant and travel. Those usually move the fastest. Same with automotive in the digital space. But also, scary enough, we as people will have a rating. And so how can someone have a rating? Well, they have a rating on a tool like LinkedIn because you get recommendations from your bosses, from your peers. And also now LinkedIn has a new tool, just like on Facebook, where you can like something. On LinkedIn, which those of you guys that aren't familiar with LinkedIn, it's actually the Facebook. It's like the business version of Facebook. And they've got 200 million users globally. 70 million of them are from the United States. So they still have a lot of room to grow. But their business model is very sound. That's why their stock trades for roughly about $160, where Facebook's trades for about $26 today. So it's just something to be aware of. But on LinkedIn, they've also come out with likes. They call them endorsements. So someone, if you're on LinkedIn, can endorse you and say, hey, this person really knows about oil and gas. Or this person really knows about marketing. or creative writing. So those are how, that's how people are being rated. There's another tool called Clout. And what Clout does is it takes a score of 0 to 100, 100 being the highest, and it tries to give you an influence score, and they do it by market segment. So it might be that a person has a score of 70 in the oil and gas market, or someone has a score of 80 in the movie market. And so the way companies use this is they reach out to Clout. Say you're a movie that's about to be released in LA, and you're the Sony, and you're the ones that are producing this movie. So Sony will reach out to Clout and say, please send a note, a text, a tweet, an email to anyone with a Clout score of 80 or higher in the LA area in the movie industry. So everyone that has an 80 or higher Clout score gets this note that says, hey, you're invited for free to go to this movie premiere with the actor Matt Damon, and you can meet Matt Damon. And so the reason they do that is because these people then show up at the premiere, and then they're influencing all of the people that follow them digitally. Or at Fashion Week in New York, to get into certain parties, you had to have a Clout score of 70 or higher to get into the parties in New York during Fashion Week, which was nice because I normally wouldn't have been able to get into a party, but since I had a high Clout score, they let me in, so it was good. So as we look at it, we go, how do we have success? Eric, this is great. Just tell me. I came here. I'm business. Give me the secret pill on how to have success within social media. Well, the good news, bad news answer to that is that the good news is there is no secret pill. Now, how can that be good news? The good news is there's no secret pill, and that's good news because that means that not everyone's going to be able to do it. So who can do it? What are the keys to success? The main key to success is, again, this isn't technology, it's about relationship building. And so who's going to roll up their sleeves and actually want to work hard to develop those relationships both offline and also online with their customer and also their prospects? But the main keys are if you listen, interact, react, and then sell, you'll have success. Listen. That means listening for when people talk about your company, your product, your service through these online tools. Then it's interact. They want you to join that conversation. Then the third piece, and this is where most companies get it wrong, they don't react based on listening and interacting. So a lot of companies are good at listening and interacting, and then they do nothing about it. So if your customer or client is telling you, we love this about your product and service, are you adjusting today, real time, to do more of that? Or if 90% say, we don't like this about your product and service, are you changing today to change the way you do business so you're doing less of that? Then the last piece is to sell, which a lot of people in here probably say, no, we sell first. We got to sell first. That's the whole key to business. We got to sell stuff. But what we found company after company is it doesn't work in the digital world trying to sell first. And that makes sense because it doesn't work in the offline world trying to sell first. Because the way that would look is that the reception before this is it would look is that you went up to four people and said, four people you didn't know, they're having a good time, they're laughing, telling stories. If you walked up to them and said, excuse me, can I interrupt you for 5 minutes and tell you why I'm great for the next 5 minutes? That wouldn't work out so well in the offline world. It doesn't work well in the digital world. It's analogous to going into the bar or cocktail party and opening up your jacket saying you've got some watches to sell. Yet, company after company tries to get in there, they try to sell right away, they learn it doesn't work, and then they figure out it's all about listen, interact, react, it's about that engagement. Now, the beautiful thing is your client and your customer do the exact same thing. So how many of you guys bought something in the last 2 months? Right, so we all forget that we're customers. And so what do? We listen. What can I expect from this product or service? Then we interact with it, meaning we buy it. And then we react to it. Based on our expectation before we bought it, our reaction's either good or bad. Now, what I told you is nothing new. That's been going on for hundreds of years. It's the last step that's new. It's now the client and the customer can sell for or against you using all of these digital tools that are out there today. That's the main shift. Your customer can sell for you or they can sell against you based on their expectation and their experience. So before I get into that, what I want us to look at is that there's an old saying in Silicon Valley that there's a company out there that's putting a bullet with your name on it today. And they're going to try to displace you. They're going to try to disrupt your business. And so it's not a question of if, it's a question of when you get disrupted. So the good companies understand that we're going to get disrupted. So wouldn't it be good if one of our companies was the one that disrupted ourselves? And so that's what we always got to remember is what would the competition be doing out there today to displace us? So I'm just going to show you a quick 60-second video. And this showcases in the last couple years everything that's kind of been displaced. Through the fun part of the program, we're going to look at different case studies of people that did social media well and some that didn't do it so hot. They stumbled, but at least they learned from when they made that mistake. So this first video, how many of you guys have seen the video United Breaks Guitars? Okay, just a handful of you, but let me set it up. This guy was flying from Nova Scotia into the United States, and he's a musician. He's not James Taylor, but he is a musician. And along the way, his guitar gets damaged. And so for the next year, he was on the other side of bad customer service with United Airlines. And no matter what airline, we've all somewhat been on the bad side at some point in time in that situation. So after a year, they said, sir, just go away. We're not paying for your guitar damage. And so he said, well, this is a new day and age. I'm a little frustrated, but I have new outlets I can use. I'm a musician. I'm going to write a song about this experience, and I'm going to post it on YouTube. So this is his story on YouTube.
United Breaks Guitars. Alaska, I confirmed what I suspected. Mike Taylor had been the victim of a vicious act of malice and a wound. So began a year-long cycle of pass the buck, don't ask me. And I'm sorry, sir, your plane goes nowhere.
All right. We'll stop the video right there. It goes on for a couple more minutes, but you can watch the whole thing on YouTube. It's got 15 million views on YouTube. And the company, United Airlines, gave him a guitar the same day that he posted that on YouTube. So by not listening, interacting, reacting, they didn't do so well, and they didn't save any costs because I wound up having to give him a guitar anyways, and now there's 15 million views of a musical called United Breaks Guitars. But I don't want to focus too much on that. I want to focus on the opportunity that was also out there. Did anyone hear what kind of guitar he uses? Taylor Guitars. So Taylor Guitars, Bob Taylor at Taylor Guitars out of California, reaches out and says, we're going to give you two brand new guitars. Sorry this happened to you. We'd like to invite you and your wife to come visit us and visit our facility in California. And then Bob Taylor, same day, gets on and just shoots a quick video, nothing fancy, just with his iPhone, just saying, hey, this happens to a fair amount of our musicians with our guitar. To prevent it from happening to you, here's three tips when you travel so it doesn't happen to your guitar. So Taylor Guitars takes advantage of the situation. There's another company that produces guitar cases. And so they now have, this musician's name's Dave Carroll. They reached out to Dave, and now they have a Dave Carroll guitar case. And our Canadian friend Dave's done really well for himself. He sold a bunch of songs for 99 cents on iTunes, that video I just showed you. And he also has a book, I don't have it here with me, but he has a book that's called United Breaks Guitars. So there is opportunity all around us if we just listen for it properly. Okay, this video is going to play in a second, but let me set it up. And again, there's some swearing in this video, so I apologize. I'm going to mute it at the point where he does swear, but this is on YouTube, such as this, with the swearing in it. And so some of you guys will recognize this newscaster. And what happened is that, does anyone remember what Rickrolling was a couple years ago? So Rickrolling was, you might get an email that says, hey, check out the latest sales figures. We're doing really well this quarter. And you'd click on that hyperlink and think it's going to take you to an Excel spreadsheet. But instead it takes you to a 1980s video from Rick Astley, which you'll recognize the song once I play it. But you had been Rickrolled if that happened to you. So they decide to Rickroll Bill O'Reilly, and we'll see what his reaction is like to being Rickrolled. And again, apologize for the swearing. I'll try to mute it at the point where that happens.
That's tomorrow. And that is it for us today. I don't know. Whatever it is, it's not right on the teleprompter. I don't know what that is. I've never seen that. Okay, but yeah, I can't read it. There's no words on it. There's no words there to play us out. What does that mean, to play us out?
Sting is going to do, it's a video, Sting video.
What is,
for credits.
I don't know what that means, to play us out. What does that mean? To end the show?
Yeah, yeah.
All right, go.
In 5, 4, 3.
That's tomorrow, and that is that.
Five, four, three.
That's tomorrow, and that is it for us today. And we will leave you with a... I can't do it. We'll do it live. We'll do it live! Do it live! I'll write it, and we'll do it live! It sucks! That's tomorrow, and that is it for us today. I'm Bill O'Reilly. Thanks again for watching. We'll leave you with Sting and Cut Off His New Album. Take it away.
All right, so the reason I show that video is mainly to showcase that happened offline, and then someone uploaded it, a producer that didn't like him, uploaded it to YouTube. And so what it's really showcasing, in this world, we all have a digital footprint. We all have a digital legacy. We're all mini digital celebrities, all of us in this room. And your digital stamp on life is really comprised of two things. It's comprised of your digital footprint, and it's comprised of your digital shadow. So your digital footprint is anything you upload about yourself, whether it's a photo, whether it's a blog post you did, whether it's a tweet, whether it's an email. So we somewhat control our digital footprint. But the more important part of the equation is the digital shadow. And that's what others upload about us. And that could be, as in this instance, offline. So what happens in Vegas does stay on YouTube. And so that's something for us to know as individuals, but also as businesses, is that the world has changed. It's fully transparent. We did not ask for this change, but we need to deal with it now that this shift has happened. And I'll get a statistic later, but 92% of children under the age of 2 in the U.S. already have a digital shadow. All right, here's one from Chrysler Automotive. This is on their Twitter account. And what they do is they use a tool to help manage their Twitter account called Hootsuite. And so this young man that works for an agency that was hired by Chrysler to handle their Twitter account hit the wrong button. He thought he was sending this out on behalf of his personal account. And so you can see he was having a bad day in Detroit. That's where I'm from. But it says, I find it ironic that Detroit is known as the hashtag Motor City, yet no one here knows how to blanking drive. So that goes out not to his personal account, but to on behalf of Chrysler Automotive to the world. And so the agency's fired, and he's fired the same day. But I use that to set up this next example, because it's not a question of if we make a mistake, it's a question of when and how we handle it. So the Red Cross, this young lady for the Red Cross does the exact same thing. She hits the wrong button, thinks she's going to her personal account, but she blasts it to the world on behalf of the Red Cross. The difference is the Red Cross has trained their entire organization to use social media. So anyone can tweet, post, Instagram on behalf of the Red Cross. And so only about 2% of the world's companies have gotten to this level on where we need to be so that everyone in the company understands how to use this stuff. And so let's see this example. She posts, Ryan found 2 more 4-bottle packs of Dogfish Heads Midas Touch beer. When we drink, we do it right. Hashtag getting slizzard. Now, for those of you who don't use Twitter, the hashtags are designed to basically aggregate or summarize each different topic that you might be speaking about. So last night during the basketball game, there was probably hashtags national championship game, or hashtag Louisville, or hashtag U of M, so people can see that conversation, that want to be involved in that conversation. So since they train their entire organization on social media, within 4 minutes, someone else tweeted, oh, we've deleted the rogue tweet, but rest assured the Red Cross is sober and we've confiscated the keys. And so what happens in this instance is nobody's fired. In fact, their donations go dramatically up that week. The reason is because the beer company gets involved and says, hey, instead of drinking a pint of our beer, why don't you donate a pint of blood this week to the Red Cross, or donate some money to the Red Cross. And also, since this response was so funny, New York Times, Huffington Post, Time Magazine, they all picked it up. And so there's a lot of free PR out there around this. So this leads us to the point of really, and I'll show this term in a second, it's all about how we handle when we make a mistake. And if we look at the term, it's really about being flawsome. So through our flaws, we can actually show how awesome we are as a company, as a nonprofit. In this instance, it's just the Red Cross saying, look, we're human, we make mistakes, we're just human beings trying to help other human beings. So let's look at an example here from Gary Vaynerchuk. He sells wine out of New Jersey. And so he decides maybe it's a good idea, I'll get online and post video about how people can learn about wine. You can become an expert just like me, Gary Vaynerchuk. And so let's look at his first episode that he does.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the first episode of Wine Library TV. I am Gary Vaynerchuk, Director of Operations here at Wine Library at winelibrary.com, and I am very proud to launch what we think is the first video wine blog. We've been talking about doing a blog here at Wine Library for a long time.
All right, that's Gary. That's kind of what you'd expect from a wine show. He's got a nice cashmere sweater on. Everything's neatly arranged. He's talking in a civil tone. And so what happens? Nobody watches this video. But instead of just giving up on the idea, he understands in the digital world it's about failing fast, failing forward, failing better. It's about listening, interacting, and reacting. So he listens to his fan base, and they say, Gary, this is super boring. I can get this from books. I can get this online and other videos from wine connoisseurs that are actually way smarter than you are. But I want to learn from you, Gary, because you're exciting. Where's the real Gary Vaynerchuk? Where's the New Jersey Gary? Where's the energy that we all love? So what Gary does is he says, instead of saying, oh, this video stuff doesn't work, he actually listens, interacts, but most importantly, he reacts. So let's see if we can notice a change when we look at episode 505.
TV. I am your host, Gary Vaynerchuk. Say it with me, Vayniacs. And this, my friends, is the Thunder Show, a.k.a. the Internet's most passionate wine program. I'm a 20% Mouvedra, $20. Pretty nose, like an ink clear, like, you know, let's give it a whirl. Nice fruit, dark chocolate, so let's go with like a 70% cocoa count coming through on this. Some lavender on the back end, which I like.
All right, so that's Gary. Much different, not for everybody, but it is for his user base. And one of his favorite lines, and one of my favorite lines he has, is that this wine tastes like your girlfriend's hair smells after she's come back from camping for the whole weekend. And so that's Gary, love him or hate him. But his wine sales went from 4 million, and then 2 years later, to 50 million from doing this, engaging with his customer. If you look, there's a lot of New York Jets stuff in there, because he wants to own the New York Jets. So he gives that insight to his fan base, so they're behind him to try to help him fulfill his dream. And that's really about being flawsome, failing fast, failing forward, failing better. We're not going to get it right the first time. It's all about listening, interacting, reacting. All right, so let's look at Wheat Thins. How many people buy crackers online? Yeah, it's still one of those unique products you have to go into the store and get. You can buy it on Amazon if you want to, but nobody does. And so if we look at this, Wheat Thins could have said, oh, this isn't for us. This is for Nike or the wine guy or Adidas to use all this crazy mobile and digital tools. It's not for us. We sell crackers. That's not digital. And you can do that for, besides Wheat Thins, you can do it if you're oil and gas, B2B, an organization, pharmaceutical company. You could say that down the line. But instead, what Wheat Thins said was, well, let's go see if anyone really talks about crackers online. Turns out a lot of people talk about crackers online. And a lot of people talk about Wheat Thins online. And this one young lady in particular, she posts, oh, I'm out of Wheat Thins. My life is officially over. Now, if you're like me, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, man, I wish I had that girl's life. It sounds pretty easy. But what does Wheat Thins do about it? Let's find out. They find this tweet, and let's see if they do anything about it.
This one's hilarious. Ah, I'm out of Wheat Thins. My life is officially over. Kind of dramatic.
Tabitha.
Yes.
Okay, do you recall tweeting, ah, I'm out of Wheat Thins. My life is officially over?
Yeah.
We got a hold of that. We just want you to be sure that you're aware that we have plenty of Wheat Thins. And that's for you. That's just a gift.
That is a lot of Wheat Thins. Oh, my gosh.
Everybody in the van. Let's go. In the truck. You take care, all right? Come on, boys. Who's next?
All right, they do a good job with it. I show that again because no matter what industry you're in,
It might be a 1 to 10 scale of how much you can use social media. So if you're in the travel industry, it might be a 10. If you're in the shoe industry, it might be a 10. But if you're in a different industry selling stealth bombers, it might be a 1 or a 2. It's never a 0. So you need to maximize that 1 or 2 or that 4, depending on where you sit in the industry. So it all depends on what you're selling, but there's always a play. All right, so if we look at furniture, IKEA, this is interesting. What they do is that if you're trying to figure out what your apartment or room in your house looks like, you can go to IKEA, and it'll help you based on your location. So you can either input this or you can pull it from your social networks. Based on your location, it'll design your room for you. So a room in San Francisco will look much different than a room in Indianapolis. And also, oddly enough, they'll also, in the photos on the wall, they'll pull in images from your social network. So it's actually a picture of your mom in your room or a picture of you and your girlfriend in the room. So that's how it's using this technology to actually give you a room that's customized to you based on all your behavior out there digitally. Now, what about B2B? So a lot of people are saying, well, B2B, it doesn't work. It's only for B2C. These sexy companies can use social media. Actually, the B2B play is even stronger because, again, it's about these relationships that we build. And in B2B, you have less relationships, but they're deeper and arguably more important. And so as we look at B2B, you can see the statistics up here. 90% use Facebook, 53% use Twitter. If you look down here, LinkedIn generates more leads than Facebook, Twitter, or blogging for B2B, which makes sense because LinkedIn is the Facebook for businesses. But let's look at an example with IBM. IBM, when they listen, and they're out there listening, they're listening for two terms. They're listening for RFP, which stands for, the other term they listen for, request for proposal. So when they see RFP or request for proposal, they know that that big B2B company is looking to perform a search to buy a service to help their company. They're developing that request for proposal for potential vendors. But once IBM sees that digitally, they can then reach out to those companies and say, hey, we saw that you're trying to do an RFP. We actually have some templates if you need to use them for RFP, or what are you looking for? Because we might also have that service that you need. And so they've increased their sales 400% in that sector. So we're talking 400% with IBM, that's in millions of dollars. So that's how effective it can be. And if you've heard the big term, big data, that's essentially, they're taking all the data that's out there, the big data, and making it actionable. So they're just looking for those terms, RFP and request for proposal. And that's a use of big data in action on the B2B side. Also, if we look, history repeats itself because no one listens the first time. If we look back 10 years ago, when Google first became a hot commodity in the search space, most people thought that there would be a B2B search engine. Whatever that would have been called, they thought there had been the Google for B2B. But what happened? It's just one search engine that we all use. Because there's people in those B2B companies, and when they're used to using different technology at home, that's what they're going to use. So again, this stuff, it's a big opportunity for companies to jump on it quickly. The other thing, the analogy to look at several years ago, again, going back 10 years ago, is that the great companies, there's paid search and there's organic search. So if you look at Google, you see those sponsored ads, there's usually 10 of them. That's paid search. That's essentially 35% of all the clicks on Google are the paid links. But if we look at 70% of the clicks being on the organic links, those are the links in the middle, and those are free to companies. The great companies, all companies did paid search because that was easy. They could pay a certain amount, figure out if someone clicked and if they ordered or became a lead. That's a no-brainer. Every company did that. But the great companies wanted to figure out, how do I show up in the organic search? How do I become number one in the free listings if that's where 70% of the clicks happen and they're free? And so even though they didn't know what meta tags were or hyperlinks or optimizing your site for search, the great companies forged ahead and went ahead and did it, not knowing if they'd get a return on that investment a year or 2 years from now, because sometimes it took a while to become number one in Google. But But by making that investment, all of a sudden these companies did become number one, number two, number three in organic search. They made millions and sometimes billions of dollars because of those placements. The same thing's happening here now with mobile and social. Those that move adroitly and embrace it will get the payoff. I'll send this out to you. This is just a sheet that has a bunch of free tools on it that you can use, either for your personal brand or for your own business. But one tool that you guys should be aware of, especially at a networking event like this, is, unfortunately, it's not on the Android yet. They're trying to code it for the Android, but it's on the iPhone, is a tool called Card Munch. And so whenever you get a business card, what you can do is take a picture of that business card, and it'll automatically upload to your contacts on your phone. And then I'll also look to LinkedIn to see if that person has a profile on LinkedIn. And if they do, it'll pull over the picture and all their information. It'll also allow you to connect with them on LinkedIn. So it's a free tool. It's called Card Munch. If nothing else, it'll save you from typing in all those business cards when you make those contacts. So now we're going to talk a little bit about LinkedIn, just because this is a business event. There's some students in the room. But as we looked at LinkedIn, before I get into that, some of us always ask, how do I attract more followers? How do I get more followers on Twitter? How do I get more people to like me on Facebook? How do I get people to repin my stuff on Pinterest? And that's the wrong question to ask. How can I get you? You got to reverse that question and ask, what can I give you? And then once you do that, if you give, then you'll get in the digital world, just as in the offline world. If you give, then you'll get. So if we look at that, when I sat down to write the script for that video that I showed that opened this up, is I didn't ask, what can I get from writing this? What can I get if I do this and produce this video? I asked myself, what can I give the audience of value? And then that way, that gives it a chance to go viral. Both sides of the house win when you ask, what can I give first, then what can I get? It gets back to the old Dale Carnegie approach, that you'll attract more followers in 2 days trying to figure out what's of interest to them than you will in 2 months just trying to get them interested in you. So it's more important to be interested in what they want than it is to get them interested into you. So if you go on LinkedIn, if you've got 100% profile completion on LinkedIn, meaning you've got your image up there, you've got your where you went to college, you've got what your business experience is, and LinkedIn will tell you what percentage completion you are and how to get there. Usually takes about 10 minutes to get 100% profile completion. But if you do that, then you'll get 40 times more job opportunities. Or if you're not looking for a job, you'll get 40 times more business opportunities, business partnerships, by having your profile at 100% completion on LinkedIn. So 91% of companies use LinkedIn when they're in the hiring process. I don't know how that's not 100%, but it's 91% use it to vet out people online before they have them come in for an interview. 35%, this is if they've actually had someone they want to come in for a job. During that week, they decide based on either something that is out there or something that isn't out there. If you don't have a lot of stuff going on digitally, they call you and say, actually, you're not going to be a good fit for our company based on what we've seen on LinkedIn, so you don't need to come in for this interview. So essentially, LinkedIn replaces the paper resume. And in some aspects, besides LinkedIn, just all these digital tools, as we mentioned, you gotta live your life as if your mother is watching you. And so that's a daunting thing, but as long as we try to use it to our advantage, it can be a very powerful thing. But to have a little fun with it, this is a pretty funny video from SNL just on what the shift has meant.
Looks like you have a new friend request.
Oh my God, this cannot be happening.
Well, it finally happened. Your mom is on Facebook, posting things like...
October means getting all my fall motif sweaters down. Or maybe I should just leave them up there.
I am laughing out loud on the floor.
Sure, she likes posting about her life, but she loves getting into yours.
Who's your new friend? She looks ill.
Now you have to to watch everything you say. Unless you get the Damn It My Mom Is on Facebook filter.
It's the only app that scans your Facebook page for stuff about drugs, alcohol, sex, references to your atheism, and opinions.
Go ahead and type something that your mom would hate.
There isn't enough beer in the world for me to deal with all of Glenn Beck's holy roller BS.
Now apply the Damn It My Mom Is on Facebook filter.
Boy, do I need new dungarees.
$5 coupon from Kohl's. I'll send it to you.
See, the Damn It My Mom Is on Facebook filter does what you do naturally. It lies to your mom.
Sweet.
Even changing your photos to make them more mom-friendly. On Facebook filter for when your mom discovers Facebook.
Why?
Why?
All right, they do a good job with that. But back to this, if we look at LinkedIn, what else can you do on LinkedIn? You can actually look down here and figure out who's the most recommended person in a company. You can also see when someone searches on this person, what other companies are they searching on? What are the affiliated companies that are out there? So if you're trying to do a business deal, it might give you other companies that you might need to do a business deal with as well. You can also look to see how many people are viewing you on LinkedIn. The number, is it increasing, decreasing over time for you or for your company on LinkedIn? Or for your university, for that matter, as well. There's university pages, there's business pages, and there's individual pages. When you're on LinkedIn, you can see a lot about an individual. You can see where they went to school. You can see how many people have recommended them. You can see their connections. Or you can see websites. So if you're looking to hire this person, he also is into kids' educational apps, even though he works at Bank of America. It gives you a lot more insight into that person that you might be looking to do a deal with or to hire. If you drill down further, you can actually see his recommendations per company and also see people that he's connected to that you might know. And so it tells you a lot more about that person. Also, you can see who's looked at you during the week. And so I was about to give a speak at Chrysler in Detroit, and so all of a sudden I could start to see people in Detroit that worked at Chrysler started looking at my profile a lot more. So then I walked into that meeting room, I could actually see these people, recognize their faces, and understand what they did. And also one person I went to high school with, so we were able to connect before I went into that room. Now from a university standpoint, I pulled it for this university. So it'll showcase exactly where people go to work after they go to school here. Now, if you look in the middle, it says where they work, obviously. And it's got Lamar University. So you go, how can they work at Lamar University? That happens at every school. People that fill out the wrong field in LinkedIn, they fill out the wrong field. So they put in the field where they work as actually the university where they went. So you always have to throw that one out. But you can see that the number one employer is ExxonMobil. If you drill down further on each one of these, it could tell you what they do on the right-hand column. So very powerful stuff. In the session before this, when we were talking with the students, if you're a student here, you can actually figure out, okay, there's 73 people at Exxon, and I want to go into sales, so I'm going to drill down and figure out who those people are. And you can just call them up to the switchboard, call the main switchboard at Exxon, and say, hey, I want to talk to Jim Allen. And then you're connected to Jim and go, hey, I'm a student here at Lamar University, that's where you went to school, and I've seen you've had a tremendous amount of success. I'd love to grab coffee with you for 10 minutes, or if you can't do coffee, let's talk on the phone. No one's going to turn down that call, and that's how you start to network out there properly. This one's looking at another school. If you looked at, this is the same thing, but if we drill down, this one has Dell listed because I changed the years to 1970 to 2010 to 2020, so it changes the companies a little bit more. And in this one, I selected Dell specifically. So I said, how does it break down at Dell? And it said that of the 53, 10 are in engineering, 9 are in sales. So again, this stuff's very powerful from a university perspective. And actually the way the shift is happening is that historically, if you had to call a university and say, did this person get this degree? Now what's gonna happen is there'll be a badge on LinkedIn because there's universities that are testing it out today that shares the information between their database, the university, and also LinkedIn. And it's a beautiful thing for the most part because most alumni don't update their database, but they do update LinkedIn. They don't update the alumni database. They might get all those messages and papers and emails from the university, but they never update their address. But they update their LinkedIn information. So that's why universities, there's a pilot program, they're testing it out where that's the shared information. Now, from a business selling standpoint, especially how many of you guys sell B2B? Okay, a bunch of you. So if you're in here, this is a good example. So this guy works for a company that sells security software. So the HTTPS that you see in your browser, they sell the S. So what he decides to do, this product manager, he goes, I'm going to start a group. And the name of the company is called SafeNet. He goes, I'm going to start SafeNet Information Security Community on LinkedIn, a group. Nobody joins. So just like the wine guy, instead of throwing it out the window, he goes, well, why don't I just remove our brand name, SafeNet, and I'll just call it Information Security Community. He does that, and now, today, there's 141,000 members of this group, and they've increased their sales by millions of dollars just from this group. And the guy, Holger, doesn't sell right away. What he does, he facilitates the community, and all of a sudden someone will go, Holger, man, you know a lot about this stuff. What do you do? Oh, I work for SafeNet. Oh, do you guys sell solutions? We sell solutions. Oh, let's have a meeting. So that's how you can sell in the B2B world in tools like LinkedIn groups. Now, this last video we're going to showcase here before I roll into it is that all of us need to understand with all these digital tools I mentioned, all of us have a choice. We have a choice to be successful because these digital tools make it readily available. Now, it does not replace face-to-face. You'll never replace face-to-face. It's just there to augment it. And as we mentioned, we all have a digital stamp. It's part of our digital footprints. It's part of our digital shadows. And so the question becomes, as a company or as an individual, is my individual digital stamp going to inspire today, tomorrow, 5 years, 50 years, 500 years from now? Because this stuff's in digital ink, everything that we're putting out there. And a good thing that was inspirational today, if you saw it in the news, is there was a kid that's 7 years old that's had two surgeries on his brain because of cancer, but he's a huge Nebraska football fan, so one of the players befriended him for the last year, and today they actually had him on the field at spring practice in front of 60,000 people in Lincoln, and had the kid, a seven-year-old, run for a touchdown on YouTube, and had the entire team put him on his shoulders. So that's the power of this stuff. You can either use it for gain, or it can be a detriment if you don't use it properly, or worse, if you don't use it at all. Because it's really about failing fast, failing forward, failing better. And so this last ending video just is a small poem that we wrote just to showcase how powerful this stuff is, and as a business or as an individual, you can use it to really achieve success.
Trouble melts like lemon drops.
Well, I want to thank you guys for coming out here tonight. I know we have time for 15 minutes of Q&A, but I know all of you guys are going to use social media and mobile media to your benefit to fail fast, fail forward, fail better, and to leave a legacy that matters, but also to improve your business today and also tomorrow. But I want to thank you guys for coming out, and hopefully, I think we have some questions and answers that are coming up here right now, and then afterwards I'll be signing books in the back, but thank you.